right. Good morning, church. Good to see everyone out today, and a happy Father's Day to all those fathers here this morning. We'll say more about that in a few minutes, but let's go ahead and begin with a song. We'll stand together, turn to 345. Wonderful truth, grace greater than all our sin. 345.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount, outpoured there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled.
Pastor is going to come and open us with a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we want to come before you, thanking you for that marvelous grace, Lord, apart from which none of us can be here. Lord, even the very life that we have, the very breath we breathe is a grace. Of course, the greatest gift that you've given is the gift of salvation through Christ who died for our sins. And our prayer this morning is that everyone here would have opened and received that wonderful gift that you've offered in faith, humbling themselves and looking to Christ alone for their salvation. Would help us to see that there's no other way for our sin debt to be paid. There's no other solution or remedy for the sins of this world apart from your grace. And so we celebrate, we rejoice in that this morning. We also want to take the time this morning to pray for the fathers and the families here today. We take the time to honor our fathers and our mothers as the scripture commands. And this morning, we just thank you for fatherhood. Thank you for the blessing of the home that you've designed. And may we just continue, best we know how, to abide by your truth and your design for your blessings. We ask that every aspect of this morning's service would exalt Christ, would point us to a deeper and closer walk with you. I pray if there's anyone that's wayward or discouraged or needs the conviction, convicting power of sin, from the Holy Spirit. May you do that in hearts. For those that are hungering and thirsting, Lord, those that are discouraged, that you would just bring healing to the hearts as well. And may we genuinely meet with you and hear your voice. And may we count it a privilege to be in the house of the Lord today. Again, give us your blessing, we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Let's remain standing and turn back to the beginning of our hymn books, number two. Number two, we'll sing together, Holy, Holy, Holy. Let's go back to 393, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, oh what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. All the day long, this is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, break from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect. perfect submission. All is at rest. I and my Savior, watching and waiting, looking above, washed in His love. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Thank God for these young people. And we appreciate good work Sister Lynn does with that Kids for Christ choir. Amen. Well, good morning. Happy Sunday and happy Father's Day to all the dads. And we're thankful to celebrate with you and celebrating what God's designed in the Christian family. I'm thankful for godly dads and godly father figures as well that can step in and be examples to our young people, the next generation. And that's what it's all about. A lot of special things happening this morning. Just want to go over a few announcements. And in just a moment, I'll have the Yerkes come. We're going to be dedicating Haddon today. That's very exciting. And then we have some gifts for the dads. Yes, we got something special for you this morning. But first, let's take a look at some quick announcements. I guess before we get to our announcements, do we have any first-time visitors this morning? Anyone here for the very first time? I know the Yerkes have some family visiting in town. It's a blessing to have you folks here today. And looking forward to a great service. The big announcement is next Sunday, we kick off our annual revival meetings with Pastor Barker. We're so thankful to have him come as our special speaker this year. It starts Sunday with Sunday school at 9:45, our morning service at 11 a.m., and our evening service at 6:30 p.m., and then Monday through Friday, all week long, each weeknight at 7:30 p.m. And so if you have any questions about that, let us know. And we're looking forward to just an opportunity for God to challenge our hearts, to encourage us. Every year, the revival meetings are a great highlight of our church. I hope you can make a point to be there and be ready for what God has for you. And so be praying for the revival meetings this year. And then Teen Camp, July 3rd through the 7th. See Brother Josh if you have any questions about that. That'll be here in just a few weeks as well. And then Vacation Bible School. On the back of your flyer, there's information about VBS. And pretty soon we'll shift gears and start preparing for that also. Tonight in our evening service, we'll be having the Lord's Supper at our evening service tonight at 6:30, so be prepared for that. All right, I believe that's all we have for our announcements. I'll have the Yerkes come at this time. I'm going to put on the headset here.
Blessing how God has blessed the Yerkes with now two beautiful children. And last Sunday, we dedicated Ali and Sasha's young son, Cairo. I mentioned the blessing. They got a girl first, then a boy. In our family, we got a girl first, Nikki, and a boy, Noah. And same with the Yerkes. They had a girl first, Harper, and now Haddon. The year of the boy, I guess, right? So praise the Lord for that. Amen. Carry on the family name. There we go. I want to just take Haddon for just a moment. Such a sweet, precious gift God's given to them. And he's a big, strong boy. I like that. Yeah. Amen. When we have these baby dedications, it's a chance to just reinforce what God already has designed. I think he wants to be a preacher, Brother Josh. Maybe let's wait till we pray. He might preach this morning. I don't know. Might do a better job. But seriously, it's a chance to just publicly declare what is already true. This child belongs to God. This is a child of God that we want him to grow and be taught the scriptures. We pray at an early age he'll come to faith in Christ to become a Christian. I always say during these dedications, this is not a christening. Haddon's not becoming a Christian right now. The way you become a Christian is the way anyone becomes a Christian. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He's not quite old enough to understand that he's a sinner that needs to repent and believe the gospel. But we pray that in time, God will reveal these truths in his mind, hopefully at a very early age. The gospel is so simple. A child can be saved. Amen. Christ said, suffer the little children to come unto me. It's his desire for children to learn the gospel, to learn of him at a very early age. That's why I'm so excited for the Yerkes. Obviously, they're in full-time ministry, helping here in our church, but they have a strong Christian home. From talking to them, they want to make it a point to have Bible reading in the home and Christian influence in the home, because we know what's out in the world that's trying to attack our children. And so these baby dedications are not just it's a one-time event, and that's it. Now the child is going to be fine. It's a lifetime of continuing to pray, nurture, and raise this child for Christ. And as a church, we continue praying, supporting families any way we can, being a blessing. And some of you, you've been on the road ahead of some of us, right? You can give some good advice and counsel, and that's what it's all about. And so let's pray now. Pray for young Haddon, and pray for the Yerkes family. Are you ready to pray? I'll lead us in prayer. Our Father, we are so thankful for Haddon. What a precious gift. We just count it a blessing whenever you give children to a family. It's always a gift from above. And we ask for your grace to be upon this family as they raise their both kids for you. We know it's not easy here in New York City. We can think of the financial circumstances and the spiritual circumstances. But we're thankful for your grace. That's always more than enough. I pray that at an early age, Haddon would come to understand the gospel and would be saved. I pray you would use Haddon to bring others to salvation. And if it's your will, he would even go into full-time ministry just like his father. I pray that you would use him and his generation to be a mouthpiece for you. And we pray that this family, you would just continue providing and blessing all of their needs. Help us as a church to continue to come alongside them as well. And just continue blessing each and every family gathered here this morning. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Take any pictures you can. Amen. There we go. He did very well. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, a very special day to dedicate your son, Brother Josh, and Father's Day is here. And so at this time, I'm going to ask some of our helpers if they want to come to the front. And we have some goodies for the dads. I want to have all the fathers, can you please stand here this morning? All the fathers, can you stand this morning? Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's give our fathers a hand this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. These are the ones that are shaping the minds of the next generation and the next one after that even as well. And I look around the room, fathers at different stages, young children, older children, maybe even grandfathers. We are thankful for each and every one of you for your example. And this morning we have just a simple devotional booklet and a pen that we hope can be a blessing to you. So let's have some of our dads come first. Let's have maybe, do we have any grandfathers here? Grandfathers. Our grandfathers can come first. Amen, amen. And grandpas can come, and we have some books for you. Sister Jeanette, we know you're just kind of getting for your dad. I know, don't worry. We're not going to, there's no confusion here in this church, amen. Great-grandfather, amen, amen. All right, let's see the fathers with the most children. Let's start with five or more. I think I have a guess. Five or more. Brother Michael, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. And a great man of God, so thankful for the Father Glogbe family. Praise God. All right, all the dads can come now. All the dads can come. I think we have enough workers here. And we thank God just for what it takes to be a father. It's not just having children. It's raising them, being there for them, providing, protecting, and never take for granted the fathers that God's given to us. We thank God for you. Amen. And I'll get one for myself. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, this morning I'm going to bring a very special Father's Day message in just a moment. Before we do that, we'll have our ushers come to the front and let's prepare for our offering at this time.
Offering, let's also have a special prayer for a couple of things. Let's pray for the fathers today and our families. Pray for God's continual blessing. Pray for our revival meetings that start next Sunday. We pray that's a great opportunity for the Lord to do a work in our church. I'm going to ask Brother Mark, we're so thankful your mom's home from the hospital and God's been healing her. And let's pray for this offering and some of those requests that was mentioned. Would you lead us in prayer, please? Thank you.
own godliness. Father, we thank you for the great example of the Bible prophet and the Council prophet that you raise the next generation for you know the word was brought to us. Your father that helped us guide us to be the father there. And you created us to be father that so that your gospel can be preached throughout the world from this generation to the next. We ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. It's all about Christ.
Even today, Father's Day, it's about how we can be more like Him. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's take our Bibles this morning. Let's turn to Mark chapter 5. It's been a very special Sunday, and we count it a privilege to honor the dads that are here. And I want to bring a special message in this part of our service that I hope will be a blessing, a challenge. Again, addressing, spotlighting fathers, but a truth that I think every Christian can glean from, can be helped by. Mark chapter 5, we won't read the entire passage, but we'll read from verse 21 and we'll skip down to the end. But Mark 5, verse 21 says, "And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him." And for time's sake, let's skip down, because there's a few things that I don't want to call interruptions, because the Lord knew what was happening here. But for the sake of our focus today, let's skip down to verse 35. "While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, Why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with him, and entereth in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha cumi, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straitly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat." This morning I want to preach on a Father's Day lesson from Jairus. A Father's Day lesson from Jairus. Let's stop and pray before we continue. Dear Father God, we are thankful for your word. It gives us the guidance and instruction that we need for life, not only here in this world, but also the world to come. You prepared us, Lord, for eternity. And as we celebrate Father's Day, may it not be overlooked that one of the names and titles you give to yourself is Father. It's how you want us to relate to you as our Heavenly Father. And we count it a wonderful privilege to know you in such a close and intimate way. As we look at your word, would your spirit illumine our minds and our hearts? We want to encourage fathers, but everyone here, to know Christ and to be faithful in bringing others to Christ. Help us during this time, we ask, in Jesus' name, amen. Looking at a Father's Day lesson from Jairus. Happy Father's Day. It's probably no surprise that Father's Day doesn't get as much fanfare as Mother's Day. It's just the way it is, right? That's all right. Us dads, we don't need all of the accolades and attentions, amen. Our rewards in heaven, amen. But I think it's a blessing. We take this opportunity to remind ourselves of the importance of fathers. We remind ourselves of the importance of the family unit, and it takes fathers and mothers, amen. The importance of the family unit, of God's design, a mom and a dad coming together in marriage first, and coming and having children, and raising those children for Christ. Hey, simply put, when we were kids, we used to say, first comes love, then comes marriage, then comes the baby in the baby carriage. And I want to just emphasize that, because our culture, it's getting lost on our culture, God's design. That's not to say God can't bless or work with or use or forgive other situations, but we must never get away. What's God's design, especially young people this morning? What's God's plan, his goal for us? It's a one man, one woman, and committed marriage relationship, raising children for the sake of Christ. And we emphasize that. That's the family unit, the building block of our church, the building block of any society is the family unit. And when you even look at secular people, they recognize this, that the family, the home, really is where the battle must be waged. That all the ills of society that we look at, all the criminality that we look at, all the moral perversion, the rebelliousness, these are issues that ultimately start in the home. And I'm sorry, but whenever I see just criminality and people just brazen by sin and brazen by immorality, I always wonder this: where was Father? And where was mother? I wonder what type of home this person grew up in that caused them to think this way and maybe even behave this way. You know, it's no surprise you read of some of the troubling statistics about fatherlessness in the United States. It's really an epidemic, they say, that when you go to the prisons, especially juvenile prisons, youth prisons, 85% of youths in prison come from a fatherless home. That ought to break our hearts when we hear that. Now, I know the media would like to say, no, it's race, it's systemic racism. Or no, it's poverty, or it's this, or it's that. It's... And we shift the blame where it ought to be. What's happening at home? What's going on at home that's going to instill in our children the character they need to go out and be who God wants them to be? 71% of high school dropouts come from fatherless homes. 90% of all homeless and runaway children are from fatherless homes. 60% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes. Now, as I'm preaching to you this message, I want you to know that I grew up in my home. It was just me, my mom, and my sister. And so I hope you understand my heart. I'm not preaching that if that's your situation, that you're just destined to go off into a life of sin and crime. That's not what I'm preaching. But we can't miss the statistics, what it's telling us, that God's plan works. We need a father and a mother in the home, raising children for the sake of Christ. That makes all the difference in the world. God didn't do that by accident. He knows what he's doing. That's his design. We honor our mothers and we honor our fathers. We recognize the role that fathers play. I believe fathers play an important role in teaching their children respect for authority. Why do kids feel like they can mouth off to teachers in school? There's something happening at home. Why do criminals feel so emboldened they can fight police officers and not want to be respectful? Something happening or something not happening at home. Why do people feel like they can just go out in society and just be so morally perverse and commit rape and murder and all these, and they're not even embarrassed by it? There's something missing in the home. And fathers have a great privilege. You can instill respect for authority at a very early age that really for a lifetime sets the tone for the way your children will live and behave. Fathers can teach their children that, hey, there's consequences for bad behavior. There's punishments for bad behavior. They say we're living in the entitlement age. And everyone feels like they deserve a trophy. Everybody feels like they should be rewarded for just simple little things. It's the entitlement age. And we can blame the generation, millennials, but someone had to raise them to be that way, is a fact. How are we raising our children? Are there rewards for doing what's right? Amen. And there's consequences for doing what's wrong. So parents, dads, have the privilege and opportunity to discipline their children. Fathers are providers and protectors of their family. There's a noise in the basement. Dad, you're on deck. You got to go check it out. Amen. You can bring your baseball bat, whatever you have, your weapon of choice. Bring something, but Dad, you're a provider and protector of the family. And fathers contribute so much to the family. But here in our passage, I want us to see the most important thing that a father can do for his family and for his children is to bring them to Christ. It's to see their true need. Money, career, bigger house, more clothes. What's their true need? And how can we meet that need? In our text this morning, we see Jairus. I believe Jairus was a great father. We're introduced to this man, and there were some interesting things happening in his life. There were some desperate needs that he was going through, and he knew the only one that could meet those needs was Jesus. So let's look at Jairus' life this morning. Number one, Jairus comes as a needy father. Jairus comes as a needy father. Just to give the background here, when you compare this account in Mark and also in Luke and Matthew, our Lord had been talking, he's having a conversation with the disciples of John the Baptist. Matthew tells us that information. And all of a sudden, that conversation is interrupted. And Jairus just barges on in here. And it says in Mark 5:21, when Jesus was passed over again by ship onto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet. Jairus just barged in, interrupted what was already happening. It was urgent. He had a great urgent need. We need to know a little bit about this man, Jairus. He was a ruler of the synagogue. That means he was a very respected man. A ruler of the synagogue was someone that was in charge of the place for religious worship and instruction. That's what a synagogue was. Jews would gather in their localities, and they would have a place to meet, to teach, to study, to worship. And Jairus was in charge of all of that. And history tells us in this region there were only about 20-some-odd synagogues. So he's top 20th percentile, if you will, right, of men of his society. Rulers of the synagogue were very well respected. And the history says his synagogue in particular, near Capernaum, was a very well-known synagogue. Made of marble, it was just a marvelous spectacle, and many people would come far and wide to go to that particular synagogue. And as a ruler of the synagogue, he was in charge of the operations, of upkeep of the building, supervising the times and schedules, and choosing people to read the scriptures, to pray, to give instruction. And you see synagogues mentioned throughout the time of the Gospels, and here Jairus is a ruler of the synagogues. You might know that the Apostle Paul, when he began his ministry, whenever he arrived at a local area, the first place he went was a synagogue. That's where all the men would be gathered for teaching, for instruction. So he's like, let me go there. Go wherever the marketplace is that I can be a beacon for the gospel and share Christ. But you probably know that the people in Jairus' circle, men like Jairus, didn't like Jesus. Because when Jesus came, he was kind of throwing upside down their whole world. They were following this Pharisaical, legalistic system of good works. Look at what I can do. Look how holy I am. And here Christ comes and says, I'm coming to fulfill the law. You're not saved by fulfilling these laws and these restrictions, these regulations. And so men like Jairus hated what our Lord stood for. So Jairus was part of that circle, rulers of the synagogue. And he had this impressive background. He probably had money. He probably had dignity, the respect of everyone around him. But can I tell you, all of the prestige and money he had could do nothing for the need that was in his life at that moment, his daughter. The story here is not just about Jairus. He has a young, precious 12-year-old daughter who's in a desperate need. She's dying. Yea, she perhaps has even passed and died. And he knows that the synagogue can't help me. All of the noble people that respect me so much, they can't do anything for me. But there's one that I can run to. There's one that I can beg and plead for mercy, the Lord Jesus Christ. And thankfully, Jairus, I believe, was a saved man. He had put his trust in Jesus and knew who he was. And he comes to Christ, and we know this because the first thing he does is he bows down to Jesus. He bows down to worship him. And Christ receives that worship, by the way, because he's God. Only God can be worshipped. Worship no man. Call no man father, right? But Christ, he's God. He's worshipped. And Jairus has all the power, the prestige, perhaps the influence, the money, but he knows there's only one person that can help him. It's Jesus. Again, it wasn't easy for Jairus to go to Jesus because he's going to get a lot of flack.
all his buddies, all his co-workers, all the other rulers of the synagogue, they're going to say, what's with Jairus? He's going to the enemy, to the other side. But he was desperate. And he knew who Jesus was. Jairus presented the need. 12-year-old daughter, perhaps his only child, who no doubt we can imagine was the apple of his eye. You know, someone told me when you start having kids, be careful, they can just wrap you around their little finger. And they know at an early age how to kind of get your attention and all that good stuff. But it's a blessing. We love our kids. And Jairus, you can sense the deep love, compassion he has for his daughter. And what's happened to his daughter is the cruel enemy of death has come upon this young child. And you can just feel the parental love and concern just jumping off the page when you read these scriptures. But the point I want us to make first is that he saw the real need of his child. Father, do you see the real needs of your children? I look around the room, I know that a lot of the men here are hardworking men. You work hard, you sacrifice, and it's a thankless job most of the time. Being a provider, being a protector, just simply being there. And perhaps we can look at our children and think, you know, they need to be in a good career. Let's help them get in a good career. Hey, they need to be cultured. Let's teach them all these different sports and instruments and things that we can bring into their life to better them as people. Hey, they need to learn just to navigate life here in New York, and let's teach them how to navigate life here in this world. And all those things have their place. But listen, fathers, don't miss the greatest need your child has. Is to know Jesus Christ. The greatest thing you can do for your children is not giving them money, is giving them Jesus. And Jairus knew nothing else mattered in that moment except for Jesus coming to his daughter. And fathers, we need to get to that same place of desperation. Our children need Christ. He looked at his daughter and it was obvious there was no signs of life there. He saw the need. And perhaps, fathers, you can look at your children and you can see perhaps the spirit of rebelliousness that's in our age today. The spirit of our world today says, don't honor your parents, trash your parents, disobey your parents, go behind your parents' back, completely disregard the sacrifice, the influence they make for you. Don't even think about it, and just don't ever be thankful for your parents. I hope all the young people here this morning, you don't live like that. Hope you don't rebel against your parents who love you more than life itself. I'm telling you. You say, Pastor, you don't know my dad. You don't know my mom. I don't need to know them. The word of God is just clear. Honor your father and mother. I don't care if you have the worst father, the worst mother. You honor them best you know how, for the Lord's sake. It doesn't say honor your parents if they were the best perfect parents ever. There's no conditions there. It just says honor your father and your mother. By the way, that honoring is a lifetime. There's different stages. There's adulthood, and the obedience can shift. But the honoring of our parents, that's forever. We always honor our parents. I can't stand when I overhear people talking down on their parents. It's a wicked thing. But perhaps, parents, fathers, you see the spirit of rebelliousness in the children, the spirit of immorality, and all the music and all the perverse movies that's out there. Perhaps you see the spirit of anarchy and greed and corruption, and you perhaps can see that even in the lives of your children. And may that cause you to realize that their greatest need, again, is not having a nice house, a nice car. They need resurrection life, just like Jairus' daughter needed. Parents, as you look at your children, I hope you understand the Bible says that as soon as we come into this world, we're born dead. Dead in our trespasses and sins, in need of regeneration, being born again. And that can only happen through the touch of Jesus Christ. Jairus saw the real need of his daughter. Do you see the real needs of your children? They're spiritually dead and must be regenerated. You know, for some parents, it's just all about, well, as long as they're not out in obvious sin, they're not on drugs, they're not becoming homosexuals even, or they're not in jail, and so then I've done a good job. They're in church maybe every Sunday. They're in the Sunday school program, and we think all the machinery of the church, they're a part of that. But I think we know that there are many that grew up in church but did not grow up in Christ, that were around the gospel, around Jesus, but never truly knew Jesus. And Father, you might say, it's the pastor's job to win my children. It's the Sunday school teacher, they better get to my children. No, sir, it's your job. You better be desperate about it. You better be like Jairus and say, I'm desperate, Lord, I need you on behalf of my children. He was in a desperate place, Jairus. He saw the real need of his daughter. And he came to faith that Christ was the answer. Christ can come and raise her to life. That's the reason he was there. Secondly, Jairus besought Jesus. Look at verse 23, Mark 5:23. It says, and besought him greatly. I love that. He's recognizing that I need help. I can't do this on my own. And perhaps as parents, as fathers this morning, we realize our own helplessness, that what can we provide for the needs of a soul, the needs of a spirit, what can we do for that? And these children in our homes, they're being afflicted by, you might say, well, my child isn't dead like Jairus' daughter is, but as I mentioned earlier, the spiritual death of man, the cruel enemy of sin, yes, it's in all of us. It needs to be dealt with. We all have to come to Christ. And I know we think our children, all of them are little angels. But the reality is, the Bible says, everyone that comes in this world, even our children, are dead and need to be born again. The old enemy of sin is stealing the hearts of our children. I mentioned all of the sins of our day, so prevalent and targeting our children even. And we have a child that you could say in body is dying. That's certainly the process. But spiritually, the spirit, the soul are dying. And Father, what are you doing about it? The Bible says Jairus besought him greatly. The word beseech means an urgent request, to plead, to beg. And the Lord Jesus honors Jairus' faith because Jairus humbled himself. I want you to see a few things about Jairus coming to Jesus in this way. In coming to Christ, he's renouncing all of his fatherly power. He said, there's nothing I can do. There's no magic Dr. Spock technique. There's no manipulation. There's no tricks that I can use. I can't do this on my own. He renounces all of his fatherly powers. He renounces his own religion. I mentioned he's a Jewish person, a ruler of the synagogue. Those folks did not like what Christ preached and stood for. But he's renouncing his own previous faith and religion to now embrace the gospel of grace, embrace Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior. It's a powerful thing what's taking place here. And he's humbling himself and putting his faith in Jesus. You know, he recognized that religion couldn't help his daughter. And the same is true today. Empty religion is not going to help. I encourage all parents, bring your kids to Sunday school. Get your teens a part of the teen ministry. Get involved in church. Serve along in the church with your children. Lead by example. But again, you must know that these are not the things that bring salvation. I'm thankful for these ministries. They're means of God's grace, but ultimately our children need to know Jesus. Not just church ministry, but Jesus. And Jairus knew religion is not going to be the answer here. Jairus knew something we need to understand. That although we might feel our children are not out there in the world, they're here in the church, our children in here need the same miracle as the person out in bondage of obvious sin. Our children need the same miracle as the drug addict, as the homosexual, as the prostitute. The same miracle must take place in their hearts of regeneration, being born again. So many parents, they're just content, well, they're not super out in the world, so everything's fine. And they miss the truth of being born again. We looked at that last week. Let's turn there really quickly to John chapter 3. We looked at the scripture. But I want to reemphasize it. You cannot be saved. You cannot have a home in heaven unless you're born again. In John 3, our Lord's talking to another religious leader, Nicodemus, and he says in John 3, verse 5, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Look at verse 7. "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." There's no substitute. There's not religion, there's not good works. We must be born again. Only Christ can do that for us. And it's a blessing, it's an honor, because Jesus saw the faith of Jairus and he honored that faith. Let's go back to our text in Mark 5. Jesus honors Jairus' faith. You know, the blessing is that Jesus knew the needs of this little girl. He knew. And he knows the needs of your children and the needs of my children. And I believe our Lord shows his love and compassion in this miracle here. In Mark 5 and verse 35, says, "While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter's dead. Why troublest thou the master any further?" As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, "Be not afraid, only believe." You know, he gave him that word of comfort. "Don't worry. Don't be afraid. Trust me. I know what I'm doing." Just to give you a quick background, there were some interruptions. The woman with the issue of blood came in, and Jairus could have said, "Hey, it's not your turn." But our Lord, he was just ministering to whoever God put before him here. But then he turns the focus back to Jairus to encourage him. "Be not afraid, only believe." What important words that we need today. And Jairus had to continue a journey of faith, waiting to discover what Jesus could do. Well, in those days, when someone died, there was all types of ceremonial things and rituals that they would do, and they would literally even hire people to come perform music and to mourn. Part of their culture, and we see some of that in the other gospels. But here in Mark 5 verse 38 says, "And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult and them that wept and wailed greatly." There was a big to do in that home because that daughter had just died. In verse 39, "When he was come in, he saith unto them, Why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth." Oh, he knew what he was going to do. He knew the power that he had, and that this was not the end of this girl's life. And I want you to see that even in the face of hopeless situations, Christ can work. There's some parents, perhaps, that have wayward children. Parents, perhaps, that you're discouraged because it doesn't look good, spiritually speaking, for your children, and you don't know what to do about it anymore. That's Jairus. And in a hopeless situation, our Lord tells him, "Be not afraid, only believe." Our Lord tells him, the damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. I still have plans. I'm still working. And we can say, for those that we're praying for that are still lost, well, they ain't dead yet. Amen. That there's still hope. Christ still wants to save and work in their hearts. But we need to be like Jairus, praying, beseeching, begging, pleading, interceding. And our Lord here honors that faith. And despite all the scorn and all the mocking here, our Lord comes in and says, "She's not dead, she's sleeping." And with a word of love and power, raises her from the dead. In verse 40, it says, "And they laughed him to scorn, but when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and mother of the damsel and them that were with him, entereth in where the damsel was lying, and he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her, Talitha kumai, which being interpreted is, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise." And she resurrected. She was walking in new life, you could say. In verse 43, she was eating. Well, it says she was 12. I guess that's about a teenager. They like to eat. Amen. How many of you know that? Empty fridges all the time. But I want you to know the power of the resurrected life that Jesus gives to your children. They're walking newness of life, feasting on the manna that God provides. Amen. That's our desire, to see our children transformed. Not to become like us, but to become like Christ. Walking in newness of life, following Christ, eating the things of God. And Jairus saw that firsthand. And I believe it happened because he came to Jesus and begged, pleaded with Christ, besought Christ greatly, trusted in Christ. And Christ moved on his behalf. I hope for fathers this morning especially, but we can apply this to all parents and all Christians really, that we all should have a burden for the next generation. We all should have a burden for the lost around us. And we see through to their deepest real needs, that they're dead and they need resurrection life that only Jesus can give. Hope we see that we can play a great role in beseeching Jesus on their behalf, just like Jairus did. He had a very happy Father's Day that day when Jesus came to his house and raised his daughter to life. And may it be a very happy Father's Day for families that perhaps we still want to see salvation come to those in need. Oh, let's beg Jesus. Let's beseech him greatly, trusting his power, trusting that he wants to seek and to save that which was lost. And this morning, I hope that we're thankful. Maybe you're here because you had a Jairus in your life. Thank God for that. Praying parents, people around you that interceded on your behalf, that trusted God and led you to Christ. Thank God for that. And fathers have a great privilege to be like Jairus this Father's Day. I'll close with a simple poem I read this week. It says, "His shoulders are a little bent, his youthful force a trifle spent, but he's the finest man I know. With heart of gold and hair of snow. He's seldom cross and never mean. He's always been so good and clean. I only hope I'll always be as kind to him as he's to me. Sometimes he's tired and seems forlorn. His happy face is lined and worn. Yet he can smile when things are bad. That's why I like my gray-haired dad. He doesn't ask the world for much, just comfort, friendliness, and such. But from the things I've heard him say, I know it's up to me to pay for all the deeds he's done for me since I sat rocking on his knee. Oh, not in dollars, dimes, or cents. That's not a father's recompense. Nor does he worship wealth and fame. He'd have me honor Jesus' name." Let's bow for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful for your word and the godly examples it gives to us. I pray this morning that as we consider the desperate need of the souls of lost sinners, yea, even our own children that need to come to faith in Christ, that we would be serious-minded as Jairus was. We would be urgent as Jairus was, that it's nothing to play around with. That we would see and sense the spiritual deadness, but also see the answer, the resurrection life that Jesus offers. Oh, I pray you'd help fathers and mothers and all of us here this morning to have a burden for the lost around us and to be faithful in doing the best we can to bring them to Christ. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed this morning, maybe today your need is to be saved yourself. Maybe this morning you realize you've never been born again. You realize it's not enough to be a religious person. It's not enough to just be a moral person, because to be dead in our sins means we need new life, and only Jesus can do that for you. I wonder if there's someone here while our heads are bowed or eyes are closed that would say, "Pastor, please pray for me. I need that new life in Christ. I need to be born again. God's spoken to me." Would you lift your hand? We'll pray for you this morning. I realize my need to get saved and be born again. Oh, I won't ask how many parents are burdened for their children, because I know that should be all of us. But I do want to have our pianist just play a hymn of invitation, just one stanza. And let's just spend a time in sincere prayer, that we be Jairuses today, that we beseech the Lord greatly on behalf of our children. You don't have to be a father to be burdened for young people, the next generation. Oh, but you need that burden of going to Christ.
Why don't we all stand and let's close in our chorus, number 200. We'll stand and sing number 200, "The Lord is Good." Tell it wherever you go, number 200.
The Lord is good. Tell it wherever you go. The Lord is good. Tell it that others may know. Tell of his blessings and tell of his love. Tell how he's coming from heaven above. The Lord is good. Tell it wherever you go.
Amen. We're going to be dismissed in just a moment with a word of prayer. There's no discipleship class and no choir practice today. Choir, we did mention what we'll do after the service tonight, so just remember that. We'll have the Lord's Supper this evening, so be back in your place tonight at 6:30. Hope you enjoy your afternoon. Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Brother Emerson, would you please pray for us?